Invite the audience to rise for the invocation. Gentlemen, if you would remove your hats, please. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, how majestic is your name in all the earth. We open this commencement service by honoring you, the creator of heavens and earth, and recognizing that we mere mortals are not worthy of your love and your care and your goodness, yet you have made us a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned us with glory and honor. We honor and worship you, triune God. Thank you for these graduates who we celebrate today. Thank you for providing for their needs throughout their years of undergraduate study and for helping them persevere through various trials and hardships, not the least of which is the current pandemic that resulted in concluding their undergraduate studies remotely last spring. Though they are unable to celebrate in the usual way with family and friends through a commencement ceremony, would you use this ceremony to be a joyful celebration and capstone of their work and the work you have done in them over these years of undergraduate study? Thank you for the family and friends who share in this celebration and their support of our graduates. We know they have prayed, supported, encouraged, and even prodded the graduates onward towards this goal. Would you help them find joy in today's ceremony of commencement and as they see their graduate move on to the next place of your calling in their lives? As we celebrate together, may we never forget that you, the author of all things, are the one who makes this possible. We ask your blessing on this time in Jesus' name, amen.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Great is thy Welcome to our commencement. Obviously, this is an unusual commencement within a year unlike any other. But this does nothing to mitigate the importance of the occasion or the joy or the sincerity with which we celebrate this graduating class. We welcome all of you who are participating in this commencement. We know that for the Trinity experience, that it's seldom, if ever, a Lone Ranger venture. There are many, many who support Trinity students in their journey, and I want to take a moment to recognize those. For many Trinity students, their spouse has been a crucial support during very difficult weeks, months, years of study. So much juggling goes into the life of a Trinity student, and we are well aware that spouses are often bearing the brunt of so much of that juggling. We also know that parents are often a key role in supporting Trinity students financially, emotionally, childcare, otherwise. We want to take time to recognize you as well. Grandparents, brothers and sisters, all those who've made this possible. I want you to take a moment now, wherever you are viewing this, wherever you're participating, just to take a moment to say thank you to your spouse, to your parents, to your brothers and sisters, to any and all those who are in the room with you now, who made your Trinity experience possible. We welcome you to this commencement, and we are glad that you've joined us. We hope that this signals the close of one of the most important chapters in your life. God has prepared you to go on to the next stage, the next chapter of your life, for that which he has prepared you here at Trinity, and it has been our honor to be part of that chapter.
Our Old Testament scripture reading today will be from Isaiah 52, verses 1 through 10. I'll be reading from the New International Version. Isaiah 52, verses 1 through 10. Awake, awake, Zion, clothe yourself with strength. Put on your garments of splendor, Jerusalem, the holy city. The uncircumcised and defiled will not enter you again. Shake off your dust, rise up, sit enthroned, Jerusalem. Free yourself from the chains on your neck, daughter of Zion, now a captive. For this is what the Lord says. You were sold for nothing, and without money you will be redeemed. For this is what the sovereign Lord says. At first my people went down to Egypt to live. Lately Assyria has oppressed them. And now what do I have here, declares the Lord? For my people have been taken away for nothing, and those who rule them mock, declares the Lord. And all day long my name is constantly blasphemed. Therefore my people will know my name. Therefore in that day they will know that it is I who foretold it. Yes, it is I. How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news, who proclaim peace, who bring good tidings, who proclaim salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. Listen, your watchmen lift up their voices. Together they shout for joy. When the Lord returns to Zion, they will see it with their own eyes, burst into songs of joy together, your ruins of Jerusalem. For the Lord has comforted his people. He has redeemed Jerusalem. The Lord will lay bare his holy arm in the sight of all the nations, and all the ends of the earth will see the salvation of our God. This is the word of the Lord. Our New Testament scripture reading today will be from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 8, verses 40 through 56. Now when Jesus returned, a crowd welcomed him, for they were all expecting him. Then a man named Jairus, a synagogue leader, came and fell at Jesus' feet, pleading with him to come to his house, because his only daughter, a girl of about 12, was dying. As Jesus was on his way, the crowds almost crushed him, and a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. But no one could heal her. She came up behind him and touched the edge of his cloak, and immediately her bleeding stopped. "Who touched me?" Jesus said. When they all denied it, Peter said, "Master, the people are crowding and pressing against you." But Jesus said, "Someone touched me. I know that power has gone out from me." Then the woman, seeing that she could not go unnoticed, came trembling and fell at his feet. In the presence of all people, she told why she touched him and how she had been instantly healed. Then he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace." While Jesus was speaking, someone came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue leader. "Your daughter is dead," he said. "Don't bother the teacher anymore." Hearing this, Jesus said to Jairus, "Don't be afraid. Just believe, and she will be healed." When he arrived at the house of Jairus, he did not let anyone go in except for Peter, John, and James, and the child's father and mother. Meanwhile, all the people were wailing and mourning for her. "Stop wailing," Jesus said. "She is not dead, but asleep." They laughed at him, knowing that she was dead, but he took her by the hand and said, "My child, get up." Her spirit returned, and at once she stood up. Then Jesus told them to give her something to eat. Her parents were astonished, but he ordered them not to tell anyone what had happened. This is the word of the Lord.
Congratulations, graduates. You made it. You fought the good fight. You finished the race. Now, there may have been moments when you thought to yourself, you know, the way this fight is going, maybe it's time I bowed out. Or perhaps there were days when you said to yourself, you know, the way this race is going, I think I might just turn this marathon into a half marathon and come back later. Maybe much later. But you stuck it out. It wasn't too long ago that you first matriculated here at Trinity, but now you are graduating. Maybe you didn't think that this day would ever get here, but it has. The day has finally come, and you are to be congratulated for your fine achievement. Of course, as we are all so well aware, your educational experience here at Trinity has been different from just about any other class that has gone before you. You have been made to endure this grand interruption brought on by a global pandemic. Earlier this spring, when we made the decision to delay graduation, we were hoping that we would be able to have a face-to-face graduation in the fall, maybe in October. Yet soon enough, we realized that an October 2000 face-to-face commencement was no more practical than a May 2000 face-to-face commencement. If it feels like your final semester has been interrupted, it is no less the case that a normal graduation has been interrupted. But that's okay. When life gets interrupted, my mind sometimes gravitates back to a certain quote by that wonderful Christian thinker and writer C.S. Lewis when he says this: "The great thing, if one can, is to stop regarding all the unpleasant things as interruptions of one's own or real life." The truth is, of course, that what one calls the interruptions are precisely one's real life, the life God is sending one day by day. Now, generally speaking, I'm suspicious of moralizing quotes, especially when they become the basis for commencement addresses. But in this case, I want to make an exception. Lewis has put his finger on something that I think is worth pondering, not only when it comes to unforeseeable black swan events like global pandemics, but also things like graduation days. Graduates, here's the thing. Now that you've finished the race and gotten what you came here for, you are ready to embark on a new stage in life. the things that you've learned here at Trinity, the ways of knowing, the ways of interpreting texts from the good book to the book of nature and back again, and ways of relating and interacting, and think about the world, all these honed skills will continue to serve you for the rest of your life. Today, you are qualified and credentialed in a way that you weren't when you first matriculated here, seemingly, I know, just yesterday. These qualifications and credentials, these newly honed skills, have prepared you for a new chapter. In the storybook of your life, God has turned the page, and today we are celebrating that turn of the page. Now, as you are making this transition, you may already find yourself reflecting back on your Trinity experience as a kind of interruption of real life, a parenthetical reality that is not really of a piece with reality as we know it. I myself reflected this kind of thinking when, as a full-time student back in the day, I would often say things like, when I graduate and get into the real world, or I would talk to recently graduated alumni and ask them, so what's it like in the real world? People who say such things, people like me back in the day when I was a student, are betraying the conviction that their education was not part of the real world. Students and graduates who say such things are revealing that they are reading the storybook of their own life as if opportunities like the one you've had at Trinity were but a footnote or a lengthy digression in a plot line that is generally going somewhere else. But eventually, as I came to discover, the reality is quite different. The reality is that real life essentially is a journey of personal growth and conformity to the image of Christ, and that for this reason, life is a continuing educational experience, and that your time at Trinity has been simply an intensification of real life, and that intensification is a gift. And yet, still, you're entering a new chapter. An exciting new episode, a fresh leg of the race. For some of you, you know exactly what that will entail, at least in the short run. For others of you, you're still figuring it out, and perhaps that figuring out process has been generating some anxiety. Who am I, and what is God calling me to do now? Oh, if only God would write the answer on the wall. But then, you know, if he did write it on the wall, where would the adventure be? Where would be the journey with God? In the scripture reading for today, we heard Jesus tell the story, or Luke tell the story of one man's journey, and that man's name is Jairus. As the story begins, in fact, even before the story begins, Jairus is at home and coming to terms with the fact that his 12-year-old daughter is in the process of dying. Think of the questions churning in his mind. Think of the questions that any father of a dying 12-year-old daughter would have. Was this really the way it was going? Was this the way it needed to be? Was there some heavenly book out there somewhere which decreed that this is the way it had to go? That his daughter's days were numbered only this far and no further? Or was recovery possible? Any of us who have faced a dark and foreboding horizon closing in on us have asked questions like these. This gets at one of the great conundrums of life, namely, how do you know the difference between the things that you can change and the things that you cannot hope to change? What are the things you can't control? What are the things you can't control? In what domains and in what seas can you steer the ship of your own destiny? And in what waters are you much closer to being a box helplessly stowed away in the cargo hold of a ship headed who knows where? Jairus himself was not sure about what was possible and what was impossible, but he knew of Jesus. And he knew enough about Jesus that he knew he was a capable leader. And because Jesus was a capable leader, not to mention a captivating teacher and exorcist and healer, he was also wildly popular. Everywhere Jesus went, people would mob about him,
wanting to see him, wanting to be healed by him, wanting to be touched by him, just for the sake of being touched. Maybe it was like the ancient version of our selfie. But this was part of Jairus' problem. Everybody wanted to get Jesus' attention, and that seemed to make him inaccessible and unavailable for things like home visits, a home visit that Jairus' daughter desperately needed. How was Jairus going to get Jesus' attention? How was he going to interrupt God? Well, Jairus was going to give it his best shot. Perhaps he thought to himself as he set out that morning, if I throw myself down at Jesus' feet, this will communicate that I mean business. And he does so because he's a desperate man. Now, to be sure, Jairus was, after all, a synagogue ruler, a man of dignity, stature, and bearing. But then again, if he were to come and throw himself to Jesus' feet, perhaps he could interrupt Jesus from his agenda and reset that agenda. Throwing yourself down at Jesus' feet was not the kind of thing you did every day. It was a once-in-a-lifetime gesture. But if Jairus had one nickel to spend, he was going to spend it on this one moment. Now today, you don't have to be a student of culture to realize that there's a lot of problems in this world of ours. Governments, societies, cultures, families, so many of these things seem to be falling apart all around us. And they seem to be falling apart with ever-increasing speed. Well, what's the answer? Some people will say that we need more activism. Some people will say that we need less activism. Some people will say we need this party in office. Other people will say, no, we need that party in office. Some people will say, we just need the right policies. And some people say that those same policies will be the death of us all. In either case, we're assured that if we do these things, this solution rather than that solution, magically everything will be okay. We have lots of problems in the world today, but for every problem, there seems to be more than an abundance of solutions on offer, usually contradictory solutions. Today, graduates, as you graduate from Trinity, can I share with you what I think the world needs now more than ever? Can I share with you with what the world needs more than a policy or a cause? The world needs more men and women who, like Jairus, are willing to sit loose to their sense of social power, the tokens of prestige, to their likes on social media, in order that they might throw themselves down at Jesus' feet. Jairus threw himself at Jesus' feet because he dared to interrupt God. He dared to believe that the current trajectory was unacceptable and that God and Jesus Christ needed to be brought in on resolving what only God could resolve. People who interrupt God for that one thing that really matters. Jairus and Mrs. Jairus had their 12-year-old girl, their baby, who was also their dream and their future. Today, on your graduation day, as you turn the page, I'm here to tell you that God will be waiting for you to interrupt him on behalf of your baby, that dream and future that God has given you. He is longing for you to come to him with reckless abandon and invite him back home with you so that he could have a hand in that vocational charge with which you have been entrusted, giving it life. If you aren't satisfied with how things are going in the world today, and I hope you are not, then you have one of two options. Either you can stay at home and tell yourself that there's nothing that can be done to it and God is unwilling to be interrupted, or you can actually make up your mind to invite the presence of God into the space that you call home. What's the one thing that you're willing to interrupt God for? Now, of course, there's a twist to Luke's story. Because for Jairus, it all suddenly goes haywire. Because this interrupted Jesus is now, as he's on his way to Jairus' home, once again interrupted by what seems to have been a pure absurdity. Someone had touched Jesus. Can you believe it? Someone touched Jesus, and Jesus has to know who it is. And he wasn't going to go anywhere until he found out who it was. Now, Jairus had successfully gotten Jesus' attention for his cause, but now the entourage of hope has been interrupted. And to make matters worse, Jesus' lingering continues until he finally smokes up a woman who herself needed healing. How deeply frustrating and terrifying that must have been for Jairus. Whether it was this woman who was interrupting Jairus' agenda or God, it's hard to tell. Really, it seems like a bit of both. In retrospect, we know that this particular interruption made all the difference. Because Jairus was interrupted, his journey home with Jesus was delayed. And because that journey was delayed, their girl dies, only eventually to be raised to life. Think of it. If Jesus had come to the girl sooner rather than later, Jairus would have gratefully and fondly remembered Jesus as the healer who made his baby girl well. But because Jesus comes to the little girl later rather than sooner, the synagogue ruler would spend the rest of his days remembering Jesus in awe and wonder as the one who raised the little girl, his little girl, from the dead. Jairus didn't know this at the time, but the woman who showed up to touch the hem of Jesus' cloak, she turned out to be the best thing, aside from Jesus himself, that ever happened to Jairus. Graduates, as you leave Trinity, you'll be settling into your new home, your new space in life, and you'll be taking care of your baby, your calling, your vocation, that which God has given you, your future. And be assured that you will face obstacles and hindrances and discouragements along the way. At least I hope you do anyway, for anything really worth doing includes its own obstacles and hindrances and discouragements. And for that very reason, in the face of setbacks, you will have to persevere, gently ignoring the people who tell you to stop interrupting God. But at the same time, I would urge you now not to be so focused on your calling that you foreclose on the possibility that God wants to interrupt you for something different than you anticipated. Let me give you an example. One day at another institution where I was a faculty member, I was having lunch with a dean. And during that lunch, I was explaining how fond I was of this excellent chair of our department who was doing such a good job, but badly needed a semester-long sabbatical. Now, my fear was is that the institution didn't grant the department chair a sabbatical. Who knows? This chair might lose heart, might be discouraged. And my hope was that an offer like a semester-long sabbatical would be a perk. Now, in response, the dean just shook her head and said, well, who would run the department while the chair was gone? And then, without even thinking about it, I said in exasperation, look, I said, I don't know. I mean, I would be willing to hold down the fort for a few months if that works. Well, as the story turns out, the dean took me up on the offer, and they agreed upon condition that my stint in administration would only be for a few months. And then I would get back to real life. Well, as you may have guessed, that was initially supposed to be for a few months, but it has turned into 9 years of higher ed administration and still going. Graduates, you have fought the good fight. You have finished the race, but realize that the fight was only a small part of a much larger and longer fight, and that this race that you ran at Trinity is but a leg in a much larger race. But in closing, let me tell you a story about races, or at least one particular race. It was a fall morning, and I found myself in Santa Barbara, California, and I've been traveling a lot, sitting on airplanes, sitting in airport terminals, sitting in rental cars, sitting in homes, and I just needed to stretch my legs. In fact, I was going to go crazy and do some running. So luckily, I just packed the right clothes, and I said, okay, I'm going to go running, and I'm going to find a path right along the Pacific Ocean, and I did. Now, when I got down to the pier, it was just curiously busy with traffic and people, but I got myself on the trail, and I'm running, and I'm moving along, and then out of the blue, there's this guy who passes me on the left, and he's running on ahead and just absolutely leaving me in the dust, making me feel how slow I was actually running. But the other curious thing about this guy was that he had a number on his back. And I thought to myself, that's really curious. How is it possible that he goes running with a number on his back? Maybe it was a memorabilia from a previous race. But as I'm thinking about that, I said, you know what? I'm going to let this guy challenge me. He's a faster runner than me, but I'm going to try to keep up as long as I can. He'll be my pace car. And so with heart beating, I try to keep up with this guy. And as I do, lo and behold, two other runners pass me on the left. And guess what? They're wearing numbers too. And then I'm beginning to realize that this is no fluke. And as we're crossing the street, there's a policeman who stops the traffic for all of us as we're now running together as a group and allowing me to cross. And I just nod thankfully to the policeman, and I realize I was in the middle of a race. Now, I didn't really know what to do at this point, because now there were people on either side cheering for us and offering us water, and I just keep running, and I don't know what to do. Because if I got out of the race, how disappointed would people be that I gave up? Well, finally, I just couldn't keep up anymore, and I just circled off when no one was looking, and I thought I'd explain to people, well, I was running in a race that I hadn't signed up for. Graduates, I want you to resolve now that you make your life a grand interruption of God, that once you identified your vocation, and jobs change, but vocation does not, that you bring Jesus home with you to give that vocation life. But as you live this life, also realize that God may bring an interruption into your life. And he might ask you to run a race that you didn't sign up for. Some of these interruptions that you face will be distracting from the race. Others will be God getting you into another race. Sometimes in life, you think you sign up for one race, and God puts you in another. But that's okay. Interruptions from God are always okay. Either way, graduates, as you go on from Trinity, run the race that God has given you.
Today is a day of joy and celebration for our graduates and their families. It's also a day of joy for our faculty members, for our staff, and for our Board of Regents. This event is the culmination of intensive labor and perseverance by our candidates as they've distinguished themselves here at Trinity. Therefore, it's with great pleasure that we formally present these men and women to the President and the Board as candidates for a degree in their respective majors. Will the candidates for the Bachelor of Arts please rise? President Perrin, it is my pleasure to present to you these candidates for the Bachelor of Arts degree.
By the authority vested in me by the Board of Regents and the vote of the faculty, I hereby confer on you the degree of the Bachelor of Arts with all the rights, privileges, and responsibilities appertaining thereto upon satisfactory completion of all your graduation requirements. You may now move your tassels from the right side to the left side. The directors of the academic divisions will read the name of their graduates.
Congratulations to the graduates of the Division of Biblical, Religious, and Philosophical Studies. Luke Babby. Zachary Todd Bauer. Braden Bennett. Jeff Brundage. Tina R. Davis. Hannah Elizabeth Di Silvestro. Calvin Hansen. Isaac Harden. Michaela Elise Harrington. Crandall Lewis Hemphill. Colin J. Hurst. Kenyatta Moore. Adam Schubert. Luke James Stell. Jianfeng Yi. Timothy Yeo.
It is my pleasure to introduce the graduates of the Division of Education. Tori Elizabeth Doty, Brianna Johnson, Christina Santana, Caitlin Elizabeth Summers, Jessica Alexandra Vroman.
And from the Division of the Humanities, Madeline Brooks, Ashlyn Margaret Hartenberger, Henry McLennan III, Hannah Oyabanji, Joshua Posnan, Nettie Reed, Hannah Rumpel, Elizabeth Tische, Timmy Samuel Yesudasan.
The graduates of the REACH Adult Education Program are Happiness Afulike, Jennifer M. Azurida, Tamara Briscoe, Chad Dillard, Adrian Chriselle Green Rogers, Frank Jimenez, Helen Jones, Sarah Martin, John C. Rivers, Joven Salameda, Thomas Siebert, Corinna Tello, Susan Vandenbos, Christine Cochran Wheeler, Carrie Williams, Marilyn Williams.
These are the graduates of the Division of Science, Technology, and Health. Mitchell Apple, Alan Austin, Jingqi Chang, Lois Dragomir, Sarah Grigas, Trevor James Guerra, Lexis Christine Farrick, Michael Luker, Carlos Marin Jr., Renata Merg, Christina Olson, DeAndre Pate, Matthew Allen Pearson, Joseph Ruscio, Nathaniel Chad Schmidt, Isaac Stief, Rachel Ann Wells, Rebecca Sue Wells.
The graduates of the Division of Social Sciences, Sarah Andrick, Samuel Bouchard. Tenley Bozzi. Nicholas Brooks. Jimmy Campbell. Michaela Carley. Josiah Scott Chapman. Sarah Christine Chapman. Jinwon Jiang. Amy Christine Claps. Dwight Davis. Danielle Daly. Matthew Doty. Rebecca L. Engelhart. Michaeline Friedenberg. Petro Yannakopoulos. John Haney. Sandra Haney. Karen Hemingway. Luis Enriquez. Margarita Hernandez. Skyler William Jankowski. Thaddeus Johnson. Noah Knudsen. Matthew Latimer. Kelly Lewis. Lance Jerome Lockheim. Grace Magnuson. Sarah Catherine McElhaney. Dawn Mondry. Andrew Kenneth Motanera. Rebecca Munt. Hunter Madison Siatumonga Noah. Julie Olson. Victoria Padal. Robert Permer. Carrie Celeste Engstrom. Panina Taua Sao. Ryan Sears. Joshua Tuesberg. Crystal Sharon Walker. McKenna Walker. Kaylee Ann Wallentine. Hannah Brooke Warren. Edward Windsor. Joy Young. Congratulations to you all.
Class of 2020, it's my great privilege to pray with you one final time before you leave us, and then to pronounce God's blessing on you. Let us pray together. Because you, O God, are faithful, and in your sovereign grace have brought us to yourself, and because you have entrusted this university with your holy gospel, we pray that these graduates, having first come to saving faith themselves, now indwelt by your Holy Spirit, would faithfully reflect the message of salvation as glad partakers of eternal life in Christ. Because you, Lord, are holy and holy good, may their lives be mirrors of that goodness. May others be impressed by their genuineness, humility, kindness, compassion, generosity, courtesy, honesty, and integrity. May they be good through and through, because our God is good all the time in every way. Because you, Lord, are all-knowing and all wisdom dwells in you, may they grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. May they investigate with confidence all you have made and every means and end for which people have used and misused your creation, shining your light in the deepest darkness. Remind them that all truth is your province, all existence reflects your glory. Because you, O God, are the sovereign of the universe, who will cause every knee to bow to your Son, our King of Kings, may these graduates acknowledge your Lordship each day, walking in obedience to you in all that you call them to do. May they clearly distinguish what you require of them from what they desire for themselves and what others want from them. May they discipline their whole selves, body, mind, spirit, to resist temptation in your strength, knowing that your ways are higher, your plans greater than anything they can imagine for themselves. May they die daily that Christ may live in them. Because you, Lord, are unchangeable, your Son, the same yesterday, today, and forever, may these graduates be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Because you are a mighty fortress and a sure stronghold, may they lean on you and stand in you, come what may. May others come to depend on them because they know they depend on you. Because you, O Lord, are the beginning and the end, the center of all that exists, the one who holds everything together, may they keep you at the center of who they are and make you the reason for all they do. May your Holy Spirit soul rule in their lives that when others look at them, they'll see Jesus. Because you, O Lord, are Trinity, and because you have called them into the fellowship of your Son, making them children and heirs in your family, may these graduates treat others as they would treat you and as they themselves would like to be treated. May they learn to care deeply for the diverse others God places in their pathway, seeing your image uniquely displayed in them. May they view each person's life as a sacred trust, valuing each one as your unique and special creation. Because you, O Lord, are just, may they fight for the oppressed here and abroad, binding wounds and setting captives free. In your strength and power, may they lead us to solutions we could not have imagined, answering questions we dared not even ask, bringing unity in the midst of strife and upholding the banner of truth despite scorn and derision. May they never give up. Because you, O God, are love, and because you loved them even in their sin, condemning your perfect holy Son to die in their place, bearing their blame, please make them like you. May they lay down their very lives for others, compassionately bearing their burdens, their hurt, their despair, their pain, their shame. May they give and give and give again with no hope of return. Remind them that without love, everything they think, do, and say is insignificant, and help them to put on the very love of Christ. May others know they are Christians by their love. Finally, O God, because you are everywhere present and have promised never to leave us or forsake us, may the members of the class of 2020 know that you are with them always, even to the end of the ages. May your grace undergird them, your power enable them, your love enfold them. May they live in the light of your presence here, anticipating the time when the whole company of blood-bought souls gathers in triumph in the presence of your risen Son to enjoy your glory forever. Amen. Now, would you please stand for the benediction? The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
My name is Marilyn Williams. I am a graduate of Trinity International University, class of 2020, double major in Christian ministry and psychology. The reason why I chose both majors, you have to understand a person's point of view. You get with their mental stability in order to have them to know about Jesus Christ on the spiritual side. You can't do one without the other. I am the first to graduate of my siblings, and I just think it is a great honor for me to be able to walk on today. I went through a lot of trials and tribulations, visually impaired. If I can do it, someone else can do it. I thank all the students and teachers that helped me along the way. A special thanks to Pastor Bill for being an encourager and a nice mentor to me. God bless, and hip hip hooray for me. I thank my family as well.
First, to Jane Recker, this would not have happened except that the Lord used you to encourage me from the beginning to the very end. So thank you, sister. It was autumn 1983, my first year of Bible college. Instant syllabus shock. No, I can't do this. Totally overwhelmed. As I tearfully and seriously considered quitting and going home, a young man, noticing my distress, asked if he could help. He encouraged me by breaking down the work for each course and mapped out the way forward so I could take it one step at a time. I did the work as he prescribed and finished the semester with all A's. He was brilliant, and since no good deed goes unpunished, I married him. As things happened, I didn't complete my degree as planned. We went into ministry and raised our children over the next three decades. And then, when our last born went off to college, I resumed my studies. And once again, in so like me fashion, I was overwhelmed. And again, there was David Jones to the rescue. For the next 5 years, as I chiseled away at the second half of my degree, David was there to encourage, counsel, and practically teach me. I really should have been paying him tuition. All this to say, thank you ever so much, Dr. David W. Jones. I'm honored to be your wife and to continue my goal of lifelong learning as your student in residence. Finally, I thank God for his tender loving care for me, towards me and my family, through his son, Jesus Christ. It is from him and through him and to him. To God be the glory.